Hey, great weather, huh? What do you guys think? Man. You know, we've had a lot of rain, a lot of snow this year, but when the sun comes out, we certainly live in a beautiful place, don't we? Ever since Jesus lived, died, rose again, and ascended into heaven, Christians have waited for his return. We've wondered, when will he come again? The New Testament contains some 300 references to the return of Jesus. We've always been fascinated with questions like, what signs should we look for to know when he's coming? Some of the best teaching in all the Bible is by our Lord Jesus in Mark 13 about his return. If you'd like to follow along, I'd like to look at this chapter with you this morning. If you take one of the Bibles in the seats in front of you underneath, it's on page 1017. As Jesus was leaving the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what massive stones, what magnificent buildings." Josephus tells us that the stones at the base of the temple, some of them were 40 feet by 18 feet. They were huge. "Do you see all these great buildings?" replied Jesus. "Not one stone here will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down." Can you imagine someone saying the White House will be destroyed? That's tantamount to what Jesus does here. He takes the most beautiful building in Jerusalem, the most expensive, magnificent. He says it's all going to be destroyed. As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew, James and John are brothers, and Peter and Andrew are brothers. They're the disciples closest to Jesus. They asked him privately, "Tell us, when will these things happen? What will be the sign that they are about to be fulfilled?" Jesus tells his disciples that the temple will be destroyed. His prediction shocks the disciples. The temple was built, that was built by Solomon, was destroyed by the Babylonians in 586 BC. It was rebuilt by Zerubbabel some 80 years later. But that's not good enough for Herod. 20 years before Jesus was born, he began a huge remodeling project. It went on for 85 years. He wanted to make it so beautiful that he would be remembered for centuries. One side of the temple was completely covered with gold. So when the sun would shine on it, it would blind your eyes. The other side was marble, so white that it looked like a mountain of snow. Just the thought that this would all be destroyed was enough to make the disciples sick. They assumed this meant that the end was coming, so they asked him, "When will these things happen? What will be the sign that they're about to be fulfilled?" Now, we're no different. We have a great interest in the future. When Tim LaHaye and Jerry Jenkins' books came out, Left Behind, and several of them were turned into movies, they were so popular that many of them were on the top 20 selling list for years. We're fascinated about the future. Now, maybe you don't believe in Jesus, so you're not certain that he's coming again. You don't even know that he exists. But you should find interesting what he teaches about how this world will end up. Now, before I go through Mark 13 with you, let me just tell you there's probably three different ways to take this chapter. One group believes that all of these things we're going to read about have been fulfilled. And so when Jesus says, "Truly I tell you," verse 30, "this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened," they take that verse and say, well, everything in this chapter has already been fulfilled. Another group pushes all these things out into the future. They say we're still looking for these things to happen. The only exception is the destruction of the temple and fall of Jerusalem, which happened in 70 AD. The third approach, which I believe, is that the details Jesus cites have already been partially fulfilled, but there's more fulfillment yet to come. Some of them that maybe found complete fulfillment in the past will have a double fulfillment still coming. When the Bible describes the end times, it's as if we're looking through a telescope. And so it's hard to distinguish when things happen. When you see the fall of Jerusalem, the judgment on Jerusalem, it's hard to distinguish that with the final judgment. And so that's kind of what we look at with this position. We call this position already but not yet. Jesus said many times that with him coming, the kingdom has come. Well, how do we reconcile that with the fact that Satan is still alive and there's so much evil in this world? Well, the answer is God has come with Christ and with the Holy Spirit, but Satan has not been fully vanquished. Some of it has been realized in Christ's coming, but more is yet to come. It's already, but not yet. So what are the signs that indicate that Jesus is coming again soon? The first sign Jesus shares that will precede his coming is the destruction of the temple and fall of Jerusalem. Verse 2. Do you see all these great buildings? Replied Jesus. Not one stone here will be left. Everyone will be thrown down. This prophecy was fulfilled between 67 and 73 AD when the Romans surrounded Jerusalem. And Titus ordered the temple to be demolished in 70 AD and the city to be set on fire. Jerusalem was razed to the ground. I believe God used this punishment on Jerusalem, judgment on them for rejecting his son. The second sign is deceivers. Verse 5, Jesus said to them, "Watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name, claiming I am he, and will deceive many." Verse 21, at that time, if anyone says to you, "Look, here's the Messiah," or "Look, there he is," do not believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will appear and perform signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. A noted Jewish scholar says there have been no less than 64 false messiahs since Jesus ascended into heaven. José Luis de Jesús Miranda is among them. He does not merely talk about or pray to Jesus. He claims to be Jesus reincarnated. This Jesus, would-be Jesus, from Puerto Rico, teaches that there is no sin and that his followers can do no wrong. Thousands of followers from 30 different countries around the world have swallowed his Kool-Aid. The third sign is wars. Verse 7, when you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There have been many more wars in the last century than in all the other centuries. There's wars many places around the globe. But just because there's a war doesn't mean it's the end. When World War I happened, many people said, this is it. This is fulfillment of what Jesus said. Then 20 years later, when World War II happened, even more nations got involved, they said, this is it. This is what Christ is talking about. So today we have, you know, Syrian, Turkish, Kurdish, Iranian, Russian, and American forces all nose to nose in Syria. I mean, it's a situation that could easily blow up. A fourth sign is earthquakes and famines, verse 8. There will be earthquakes in various places and famines. These are the beginning of birth pains. Again, we've seen many more earthquakes and famines in this last 100 years than all the other centuries. But just because you see one doesn't mean it's the end. In 1906, when they had the earthquake in San Francisco, people said, this is it. I mean, we've had a lot of earthquakes. I just wrote down some of the ones that we've had recently. China, Turkey, South America, Mexico, Los Angeles, Japan, Thailand, and Pakistan. Every year, it seems like we're having more and more, which suggests the end may be near. Fifth sign is persecution. Verse 9, you must be on your guard. You'll be handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogues. On account of me, you will stand before governors and kings as witnesses to them. Persecution of Christians began immediately after Christ ascended. 10 of the 11 disciples died as martyrs. Christians have continued to face persecution throughout the century. It's increased in our time. It's estimated that more Christians have died for their faith in the 20th century than the 19 centuries prior. I mean, millions died in communist Russia. Millions died in communist China. Tens of thousands were killed in Nazi Germany. In 1915, what's called the Forgotten Holocaust, 1.5 million Armenian Christians were killed at the hands of Ottoman Turks. The Global Evangelization Movement reports an average of 165,000 martyrs per year, more than four times the number in past centuries. Some of the worst persecution today occurs in Muslim-majority nations where Sharia law has become the law of the land, places like Egypt, Pakistan, Yemen, Somalia, Iran, Libya, Syria. When ISIS drove in and took over Mosul 2.5 years ago, many of the Christians fled. The ones that were still remaining were put to death. IMN tells this story, and the ISIS, they would paint a big N on the doors of all Christian homes, apartments, and they confiscated all their properties. It's ours now. And the book tells about persecution of Christians around the world. Abdi was a member of the Somali Christian community, and he was very outspoken about his faith. He led many Muslims to Christ. His activities did not go unnoticed by the authorities. He tried to keep a low profile and be careful about where he drove and keep his family from being exposed, but one day as he got in his car to go to work, Al-Shabaab terrorist circled around his car and sprayed his car with bullets. Police pulled his lifeless body out of the front seat of the car. Abdi had escaped many times before, but this time he paid the ultimate price. The sixth sign is the gospel preached to all nations, verse 10. And the gospel must first be preached to all nations. Many people wonder, why doesn't Christ come again? I think one of the reasons he has not come yet is because he's patient toward people in the world. He wants his church to take the message of Christ to all peoples in the world. Well, Apostle Paul has an interesting verse in Colossians 1:23. He says, "This is the gospel that you heard and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven." I don't think Paul was saying that he felt everybody in the world had been reached, but his point was everywhere we go, we make every effort to share the gospel with everyone. Billy Graham crusades over the last three centuries have broadcast their crusades via satellite to over 200 countries. The messages are simultaneously translated into scores of languages. South Korea has had several Graham crusades, and they've had it in 120 different cities. One Korean church had every one of its 17,000 members trained for the crusade. The Graham Association by itself has proclaimed the gospel to billions of people. Add to that other evangelists like Luis Palau, and think of how many people have been reached. And then think of all the religious programming that can be accessed today through TV and the internet. We can watch it on our cell phones. It's been Jory's observation as she travels around the world that even the poorest of the poor in countries, they all tend to have cell phones. Now, that doesn't mean they all have a data plan, but my point is we're getting closer to the point when the gospel can reach and maybe has reached the entire world. The last sign that Jesus mentions is the Antichrist. Verse 14. "When you see the abomination that causes desolation standing where it does not belong, let the reader understand that those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. The phrase abomination that causes desolation refers to an antichrist in the temple. Now, believers can engage in all kinds of guesswork. Who's the antichrist? When's he coming? I believe is that there will be one antichrist before Jesus returns, but through the centuries, Satan, who is the ultimate antichrist, raises up many antichrists. So there'll be many fulfillments of this. So Jesus' teaching is not intended to help us predict the date of his return. He says, "No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father." Well, think about that. If Jesus doesn't know exactly when his return is, how can any of us predict it? So beware of anybody who's too definite about when Jesus is coming again. So if we're not to be preoccupied with the signs, and we're not supposed to use the signs as a way to calculate when Christ is coming again, why does Jesus teach us about this at all? The purpose of his teaching about the end times is to motivate us to be ready for his return. Jesus makes it clear to ask when is to ask the wrong question. The purpose of prophetic teaching is to not to help us set dates for Christ's return, but to be ready. Peter writes, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything in it will be laid bare. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives." So the emphasis in Jesus' teaching is not on the end, but on being ready. So how can we get ready for Christ's return? I find in this chapter three things that Jesus says that are helpful to us. One, focus on the return of Christ. Focus on his return. Verse 24, "In those days," Jesus said, "following that distress, the sun will be darkened." With as much rain as we've had lately, I thought maybe this was being fulfilled here in Portland. "And the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, people will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory, and he will send his angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of the heavens." The return of Christ will be accompanied by cosmic signs. No place on earth will be hidden from Christ's return. John says, "Every eye will see him." Everyone will know when Jesus returns. And creation looks forward to the reign of Christ, so it shouldn't surprise us that there will be cosmic signs. Jesus told them that they would face persecution, but he assured them that he was coming again to make everything right. Trust in ultimate victory gives us ultimate courage. Jim Collins, in his book Good to Great, talks about this attitude. He talks about interviewing Admiral James Stockdale, who was a prisoner of war in Vietnam for 8 years. And Collins got a chance to interview him. And he says, "How did you make it? 8 years. He said, "I never lost sight of the end of the story. I always believed I would get out and that my imprisonment would become my life story." And Collins followed it up by saying, "Well, who didn't make it?" He said, "Oh, that's easy. The optimists. They're the ones who had said, we'll be out by Christmas." And then Christmas would come and go, and then they say, "We'll be out by Easter." Easter would come and go, and they say, "We'll be out by Thanksgiving." It would come and go, and then they're back to the next Christmas. He said they died of a broken heart. It's important for us to realize that we need to always embrace these twin realities: difficulty in this life, but there will be ultimate victory. That's the way to live. You always understand life stinks. It's hard. But you keep your eye on the end when Christ says he'll make everything right. The second way to be ready for Christ's return is to build your life on Christ's word. Verse 31, Jesus says, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away." Jesus says with absolute authority that everything he teaches will be fulfilled. His word is more secure than the house you live in, or the car you drive, or the very ground you walk on. The Coalinga earthquake in Southern California in the mid-70s taught us a lot about how houses can make it in earthquakes. The earthquake registered 8.2 on the Richter scale. And they learned that houses that were made of wood, that were flexible, and were bolted to the foundation, made it. But houses that were brittle, like stucco houses, or houses that weren't bolted to the foundation, they would slide off and then they would fall. They learned that if you took two pieces of plywood and put it on the corners of your house and dug it down, pounded it down in, so it holds the house to the foundation, the houses could make it. The key to withstanding an earthquake is to be connected to the foundation. Our foundation is Jesus Christ and his word. Do you read it, his word? Some Christians have never read through the Bible. Some Christians have never read the Bible as an adult. Their understanding of the Bible is what they learned in Sunday school. Do you make a practice of reading the Bible daily? Do you use our journals or some other study? You can't build your life on God's word if you're not reading it. Reflecting on God's word prepares you for the difficulties in life that you'll face. Builders of the Titanic should have been so wise. The luxury liner sank because contractors settled for cheap rivets and poor planning. Rivets are kind of like the glue that hold the steel plates together. They're the huge bolts that hold it together. Facing a shortage of the right bolts, they settled for cheaper versions that popped as soon as the ship hit the iceberg. How sturdy are the bolts in your belief? Reinforce them daily with Bible reading and reflection. The third way to be ready for Christ's return is to live each moment in obedience to Christ. Verse 33, be on your guard. Be alert. You do not know when that time will come. Jesus is kind of leading up to his climax now. It's like a man going away. He leaves his house, puts his servants in charge, each with their assigned task, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know when the owner of the house will come back, whether in the evening or at midnight or when the rooster crows or at dawn. If he comes suddenly, do not let him find you sleeping. What I say to you, I say to everyone, watch. We're to live each moment in God's will, in obedience to him, so that we're not embarrassed when he comes. I don't know about you, but this teaching of Jesus motivates me. When I'm doing something stupid or thinking about doing something like, I think, boy, it would sure be embarrassing if Christ came right now. And that somehow helps me to obey. Jesus begins his teaching in Mark 13 with the word watch, and then his final word at the end of the chapter is watch. Since we don't know when he's going to come exactly, we keep watch. We look forward to Christ's return. We build our lives on his word. We do our best to obey. And we trust that Jesus will come back and see us through in the meantime. Let's trust our Heavenly Father the way Peter Wirth trusted his father. He was a 21-year-old university student when he suddenly began to get severe pain in his right shoulder. So we called his dad. Makes sense. College students have a problem, they call their parents for advice, but no one has as perfect a father to call as Peter did. His father is an expert orthopedic surgeon who specializes in shoulders. When Peter explained what was going on, his dad's first reaction was, it's probably weightlifting. But as the days went on and he described numbness and tingling, his father suspected a condition called deep venous thrombosis. It's a blood clot in the shoulder. Well, his father, Michael, not only knew about the condition, but he wrote the article on its treatment. So he told his son, get to the emergency room, and when you get there, tell them to do an ultrasound. Turns out his long-distance diagnosis was spot on. They rushed him in. They dissolved the blood clot, which, of course, is dangerously close to the heart, and they extended his life. Wouldn't it be great to have such a father? We do. He has diagnosed the pain of this world and has written the book on its treatment. We can trust him. Everything will work out in the end. If things aren't working out, it's not the end. Jesus told us about the future so we'd be ready to meet him. Almost every prophetic scripture in the Bible is coupled with an ethical exhortation. Christ is coming, therefore live obediently. When I was in college, and again in seminary, a fellow student said to me, you know, we should stop school. Christ is coming any day, and we should be on the streets telling people about Jesus. There's no time to be doing what we're doing. I don't know if anybody, if you ever thought about something like that, or during World War II, C.S. Lewis was giving a speech at Oxford University, and Nazi Germany had just invaded Poland, 1939. And students, you know, were asking him, should we drop out of school? And his answer was essentially, no. You live each day, you know, one day at a time, and you trust the future to God. We don't know when it's going to end. We trust that to him, and we do our best to live in obedience to his will, one day at a time. If you knew, without a doubt, that Christ was going to come this week, would you drop out of school or change your vocation, stop what you're doing? Are you ready for Christ to return? Or would you be embarrassed by what you're doing? Or do you feel like, no, I'm ready because I'm doing my best to be in his will and to obey him and to love him with all my heart? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for this teaching that you are coming again. We don't know when, but we know you're coming. So help us to live ready, doing our best to live in your will, obey you, and to love you with all our hearts. One of the best ways to get ready for Christ's return is to give your life to him. If you've never done that, you can do it right now. Just tell Jesus, I believe in you and I want you to be Lord in my life. I want to give you all just a moment to pray and tell Jesus that you want to be ready and live ready each day for his return. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for bringing us here today to hear what you teach about the end. We think it's near, but we don't know exactly. But we know we want to be ready for you. Thank you that we can know that there's a good ending to what we're experiencing here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.